Hello, welcome everyone. Could I ask that folks who are sitting in the middle of back rows move as much forward as you comfortably feel? I'd appreciate that. My name is Yasmin, or Jasmine, or Yasmin, it depends on what language you're speaking when you say my name. I am the Director of Communications here at Respect Graduate School, and on behalf of the school and the staff, I would like to welcome you to our first colloquium series that will have our first lecture by Dr. Zeki Sanitoprak, who is joining us from Ohio. A little bit about Respect. We are an institution where students and faculty engage in research, teaching, learning, and service with an emphasis on Islamic studies for the public good. We offer a Master's of Art in Islamic Studies, which has two tracks, and a number of our students are commuting all the way from New Jersey. We also have local students, and the combined, we have approximately 22 students enrolled. So we're very proud to have our first year with the number of students that we have, and our goal is to, of course, expand throughout the years and build and hold and forge relationships with both the academic community here locally as well as the interfaith community. That's very important for us, of course, as we're offering Islamic studies, that we are making those relationships with other faith groups on the academic end. With that said, I'd like to just give a little brief introduction to Dr. Zeki Sanitoprak. He has held the Norsi Chair in Islamic Studies at John Carroll University since 2003. He holds a Ph.D. in Islamic Theology from the University of Marmara in Turkey. His dissertation, which examines the personification of evil in the Islamic tradition, is entitled The Antichrist, Al-Dajjal, in Islamic Theology, and was published in Turkish in Istanbul in 1992. Prior to coming to or arriving to John Carroll, Dr. Saritoprak held positions at Harran University in Turkey, at Georgetown University, the Catholic University of America, and Berry College in Rome, Georgia. He's also the founder and former president of the Rumi Forum for Interfaith Dialogue in Washington, D.C. Professor Dr. Saritoprak is the author of over 30 academic articles and encyclopedia entries on Islam-related topics. He has served as guest editor for issues of the journals Islam and Christian-Muslim Relations and Muslim World. He is editor and co-translator of Fundamentals of Rumi's Thought, a Maghribi Sufi Perspective, and the editor of a critical edition of Al-Sarafsi's Sifat Ashrat al-Sa'a in Arabic. His most recent book, Islam's Jesus, which is what we are here gathered today for, was published by the University Press of Florida. He is currently preparing a book on Islamic spirituality, tentatively titled Islamic Spirituality, Theology and Practice for the Modern World. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Zeki Sanitoprak.
Good afternoon. Nice to be with you. Yasmin, thank you for your generous introduction. One of my books, many people have a hard time to pronounce it. Sifat Ashrat al-Sa'a, you did very well. Well, this is my second, I think, lecture in this area. I remember Dr. Walter once invited me to Moravian College, and at that time I talked about Moses in the Quran. Now we are talking about Jesus in the Islamic tradition. So my plan is to talk for about 40, 45 minutes, and then I will have your questions. We'll have Q&A session. But before you ask me your questions, I thought to ask you some questions. Would that be okay? Okay, and for this question, Muslims, Christian Jews are all included, you know, there is no distinction in this case. What is the most frequently used title for Jesus in the Quran?
Prophet.
A prophet is a title for Jesus, but it is not the most.
Son of Mary.
Son of Mary, bravo. That's very good. Son of Mary, Ibn Maryam. Ibn Maryam is the most repeated title for Jesus in the Quran. And in fact, it is very much comparable with the biblical term, the Son of Man. Because, as you know, in that biblical phrase, Son of Man, man does not mean male. It means human being. And Mary, as human being, Jesus is the Son of Mary. It's very much compatible with that biblical narrative. Is there a chapter in the Quran named after Jesus? Yes or no? Is there a consensus? Can you say there is a consensus? There is no chapter in the Quran named after Jesus? Well, it seems like there is a consensus, and unfortunately, it's the wrong answer. The right answer, yes, there is a chapter in the Quran named after Jesus. As you know, the Quranic names have sometimes the Quranic chapters sometimes have more than one name. For example, the first chapter of the Quran is known as Al-Fatih, but there is another name for that chapter, it is known as Al-Shafi, which means the healed. Chapter 61 in the Quran has three names. One is Al-Saf, which means the role of angels. The second is Al-Hawariyun, which means the disciples of Jesus. And the third is Isa, which means Jesus. So actually, chapter 61 in the Quran is named after Jesus as well. So now we are refreshing our knowledge, right? There's a chapter in the Quran named after Jesus. Do Muslims believe in the second coming of Jesus? Yes?
No.
Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, I think yes. Those who say yes, they are the majority. So yes, it is true. Muslims believe in the second coming of Jesus. And I elaborate on this aspect of Islamic theology. And I have two sections in my book on this aspect of Jesus. Okay, who was Jesus? Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary. That means in Islamic teaching, Mary gave birth to Jesus miraculously. She was not touched by any human being. She is very much respected in the Islamic teaching. And Jesus didn't have a physical father. Jesus' birth was a miracle. So it's very important to explain the Quran because there are many verses on this. And because of this, it is part of Islamic theology. He is a bringer of peace. Jesus will bring peace when he comes back. He will bring peace. His role in the Islamic eschatology is to bring peace, to make peace. Now, what's the meaning of it? So I will elaborate on that, basically. He is one of the five elite prophets in Islam, along with Noah, Abraham, Moses, and Muhammad. Peace and blessings be upon them all. So we have five the most greatest prophets of God. In the history of humanity, when we say who are the greatest people, these five personalities come to mind: Noah, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad. So, for example, forget Aristotle, forget Plato, you know, these giants of philosophy. Well, there are great people in philosophy, but as far as the greatness is concerned, these five personalities are the highest. The highest of all human beings throughout, since the beginning of humanity to the end of time. They are the highest. And Jesus is one of them. And therefore, Jesus also is very significant in Islamic teaching. Jesus is a Muslim. Now, is it true? In the, as you see, I put in lowercase n, and there is a big difference between lowercase n and uppercase n. So with lowercase n, Muslim is the one who submits himself to the will of God. And therefore, Jesus is a Muslim. Moses is a Muslim. Abraham is a Muslim because they submitted themselves to the will of God. I remember I was giving a talk, I think it was at the University of Toronto, and there was a Muslim professor in the group, and he raised his hand and he said, Doctor, I would like Jesus to be Muslim with capital M.
Yeah.
I said, so with capital M, does that mean it is born Muslim, if you are Muslim with capital M? Well, I said, be careful, because sometimes you may be a Muslim with capital M, but not Muslim with lowercase m. I think lowercase m is more significant, because sometimes, and we have some Muslims who are not Muslims. Some Muslims with capital M who are not Muslims with lowercase m. You see many people who are beheading human beings, you know, they know as Muslims, but they are not Muslims, and it's very significant. As you know, in Arabic language, there is no capital and lowercase. It encompasses all. And that's why when, you know, like in the story of Solomon, the Queen of Sheba comes to Solomon, the Quran says, she became a Muslim. That means she became in the religion of Solomon. That means she submitted herself to the will of God. So for example, that was before Islam, but the Quran uses the term Muslim for this case. And that's the meaning of it. To be Muslim means to submit yourself to the will of God. It's a long story, you know, that perhaps needs another lecture. We should stay. Jesus is a miracle worker. He was able to make miracles. I will mention some of them, as I mentioned before. He's an intercessor in the afterlife. Messengers of God are able to intercede. For example, if there are some sinners, let's say, go to Jesus and say, can you intercede and ask God to forgive you? And Jesus may ask God, and God will forgive that person. Sometimes I put this in the modern terms. I say it is like a letter of recommendation. You know? But generally, God does not reject their request. Because these are the beloved of God. Jesus, Moses, Muhammad are the beloved of God. And therefore, when the beloved of God, these people, request something, God does not reject it. God accepts it. And that's we have a very important section in the Islamic theology called Shafa'at, which means intercession. Intercession is a very important principle. Now, this is in the Quran and in the Hadith. The Hadith, so for those who are not familiar, is the sayings of the Prophet. So we have references to Jesus in the Quran and in the sayings of the Prophet. Of course, it would not be possible to mention all what I have in the book, so you have to read the book. And I have to tell you, I spent 6 years on this book. So I think it is worth reading, you know, maybe that you read. So I will give something for the book. Jesus is mentioned in more than 90 verses of the Quran, characterized by his message, which is Injil. The Quran is the holy book of Islam. Even a hint in the Quran is significant. How about a personality that is mentioned more than 90 times? It becomes very important. And you know, this is true for other messengers of God, like Moses. I just wrote an article on Moses for a journal in Germany. He is mentioned 140 times in the Quran. Perhaps the most frequent mentioned personality in the Quran. So, and this shows the significance of these divine messages. Now, this Quranic verse, surely I came to you with a sign from the Lord. This is about the miracle objects. I create from clay the likeness of a bird. Then I breathe into it, and it becomes a bird by God's permission. It's a miracle. God gives power to his messengers to show miracles to people, to show the truthfulness of his messengers. So Jesus was speaking on behalf of God. And therefore, God showed him, empowered him with some miracles. And one of these miracles, he was making the form of a bird from clay, and he would breathe into it, and it would become a real bird, fly. So it's unusual. It is unnatural. Well, it's against the law of nature. I mean, you cannot. Can you make a bird from clay? Would you like to try? That was a miracle of Jesus. God empowered him with his miracle. And there are, you know, many other miracles of Jesus in the continuation of this verse. Jesus says, I heal the leper. I can inform you about what you restored in your houses. The verse actually is detailed. And all this, I resurrect the dead, Jesus says. All this is because of God's permission. So Jesus is empowered by God to do this. And that's why the Quran says, by God's permission, by God's empowerment. This is another Quranic verse about Jesus. I have come confirming that which was before me of the Torah, and to make lawful to you part of what was forbidden to you. And I have come to you with a proof from your Lord. So fear God and obey me, Jesus says. Now in this verse, we see that Jesus does not reject the Torah, but confirms the Torah. And it is very Islamic, because in Islam, Muslims believe in the four great books of God, the Torah to Moses, the Psalms to David, the Gospel, Injil to Jesus, and the Quran to Muhammad. Peace and blessings be upon the Lord. So Jesus came to confirm the Torah. He did not reject the Torah, the Quran says. He confirmed the Torah, actually. And in this verse again, Jesus says, and worship God, your Lord and my Lord. So it's very important principle in Islam that only God is worshipped. No one other than God can be worshipped. And this is the message of Jesus, according to the Quran. Jesus asked people to worship one God. So for example, you love Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. You have to love him, Islamically speaking, but you cannot worship the Prophet. If you worship Prophet Muhammad, you will be out of the principle of Islam. You love Jesus a lot. You have to love. Islamically speaking, you have to love Jesus. You have to love Moses. Because these are the messengers of God. But you cannot worship. You cannot worship Jesus. You cannot worship Moses. It is only God that can be worshipped. You worship only God. I had a colleague, a Catholic priest in Ohio, in Cleveland area, and once he told me, he said, we have a lady in our parish. Every Sunday morning she would come, and we have a small statue of baby Jesus outside of the church. And she goes in front of this statue and she worships this statue. And when I said, why don't you come in? And she said, I love this baby. I love this baby Jesus. Well, Islamically speaking, yes, you have to love Jesus. But when it comes to worship, no, you are not allowed to worship anything other than God. Respect is not worship. Respect is, which is the name of these institutions. Respect is important. You have to have a great respect for the messengers of God, for the saints, for the, you know, important personalities, but you shouldn't worship. If you make it to the level of worship, that would be not accepted in Islamic teaching. Only God is worship. Again, this chapter, this verse, confirming the Torah and receiving a new message from God, this Quranic verse again emphasizes that Jesus conferred the Torah, but he received a new message. This new message is the gospel, the message of the gospel. And therefore, this could be different. There will be some differences between two messages, three messages. Not because they are contradicting each other, but because the needs of the people of each prophet's time. In the time of Moses, there was a different need. And therefore, God empowered Moses with a miracle that was about magicians to be able to overcome the magics of Pharaoh's magicians. So he was empowered with such a thing. In the time of Jesus, healing was very important. So God empowered Jesus with the power of healing. He was able to resurrect a dead person to life. In the time of Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon them, eloquence was very important. So the Quran came in the most eloquent way, challenged Arabian people, the people of Arabia, the people of literature, and said, if you have any doubt about this Quran, bring an example like it. In eloquence. If you cannot bring it, accept. So that's why the Quran challenged them with words. Just bring words like it. Well, they couldn't. History doesn't show that they could have made an example like the Quran. There were several examples, but they were not very successful. Not successful at all. There was a fail. They were failed. So the message of Jesus in the gospel could have some new things that were not found in the Torah. And similarly, the message of the Quran can have something that is not found in the gospel or in the Torah, according to the need of the time, people's need. In this Quranic chapter that I said it is named after Jesus, Jesus asks for help. He says, who will be my helper? And the disciples of Jesus, Qal al-Hawariyun, Quran says, we are your helpers in the way of God. So the Quran praises the disciples of Jesus. And actually invites Muslims to imitate the disciples of Jesus, to be like the disciples of Jesus. When Jesus asked for help, they said, we are your helpers. They did not they did not show any hesitation. They supported Jesus. And they are praised in the Quran. Now I'd like to move at different, a different aspect of the story. And that is the eschatological role of Jesus, which is very important. And as far as I know, many scholars, many scholars have written on Jesus, but his dimension is not mentioned because people are afraid to talk about this, I think, as far as I understand. What encouraged me to speak about this was my findings during my research of allegorical meanings. So that actually gave me encouragement to be able to solve the problem, at least from my perspective. So, I found during my research, I have to confess, more than 100 books written on the eschatological role of Jesus in Islam. At the end of time, the coming of Jesus, at the end of time. I didn't know that there were so many books written. And even some of them are very inflammatory, you know, as if Jesus is coming tomorrow. So, you know, like, wait, he's coming. He'll come and they change the world immediately. I thought that this was only among Muslims. In year 2000, I was in Washington, D.C. Yeah? I was walking around White House area, I think visiting that area. And I saw a person holding a sign saying, "Mr. President, it is the millennium. Jesus is coming. Wait for him." Well, we have many Christians who think that, you know, at the beginning of the millennium that Miss Jesus will come. So wait, Mr. President, he's coming. So we have both Muslims and Christians who are really thinking of the imminence of the coming of Jesus. He's coming immediately, very soon. Some people even gave some dates, and it didn't happen, they changed the dates. Okay, so I divided these groups, these works that written on Jesus, this literature, into three categories. The first category, I call them modernist approach. Modernist. They do not accept the coming of Jesus. They say a person who died 2,000 years ago cannot come back. Forget. Now, what is the percentage of this group in this literature? I would say maybe 2%. So it's not like a big percentage, but these are philosophers. Some Muslim philosophers, modern Muslim philosophers. The second group, I call them literalists. They believe that Jesus will come directly from the sky. Directly, no hesitation. And I talked to some people, actually, who were very literalists. And I said, you know, you mean that when Jesus comes, CNN, ABC will have interview with him? You know, welcome Jesus to our world. He said, exactly, that's what will happen. He said, God is the most powerful, and God will take care of it. It will happen that way. So as if Jesus will come with parachute from sky. Now that is not my favorite approach, but I have to say, a good number of people believe that way. The third approach, the interpretive, I call it the interpretive approach, and that is my favorite one. This group of people, they say, Jesus will come, but it shouldn't be understood in a literal sense, because the prophet said it, since the prophet said about this, it will happen. But the prophet used allegorical language, and therefore it shouldn't be understood in a literal sense. Allegorical should be understood allegorically. What's the meaning of it? For example, one of them would say, the essence of the message of Jesus is peace, love, and mercy. These themes dominate our human society. That means Jesus is there. Don't wait for a person coming from sky. Work for them, you are working for the future, and you are working for Jesus, for the side of Jesus. So that's the interpretive approach. And there are some Islamic scholars who would say this about Muslim-Christian cooperation between Muslims, Christians, and Jews, the people of the world. So there are some hints in the Quran about this. I will skip this for the interest of time. Now, I'd like to say something about how Jesus is presented in Hadith, in the sayings of the Prophet. This is very well known. I think this is in Al-Bukhari, one of the most reliable sources of the sayings of the Prophet. The Prophet says, "By God Almighty, in whose hand my soul is, Jesus, the Son of Mary, will soon descend among you Muslims as a just ruler." So he will come as a just ruler. That's his role. Another hadith says, "It has been shown to me while I was sleeping in my dream," Jesus says, the Prophet says, "while I was circumambulating the Kaaba, I saw a man of brown color." The best one can see among brown colored human beings. Now, I asked one of my colleagues, what is the color of Jesus in the United States? Brown or white? It's pure white. But in this hadith, it says brown. Jesus was brown color. So it gives some description of Jesus in the hadith. The hadith says he was on the shoulders of two angels. His hair was long, the best hair one can see. He had combed his hair, and it was as if water was dripping from his head. This is, in Arabic language, indication of purity. Jesus was at the utmost purity, at the utmost level of cleanliness and purity. As you know, in the Islamic tradition, cleanliness is the heart of religion. And Jesus is at the utmost level of cleanliness in the Hadith, in the Sayings of the Prophet. And we see some descriptions of Jesus in this Hadith, basically. This is another Hadith. Jesus, the Messiah, will find some people from among my community as his helpers. So some Muslims, according to the saying of the Prophet, will be the helpers of Jesus. Jesus will find some helpers among my community. As you see, in the Islamic teaching, prophets of God are brothers. Jesus, Moses, Muhammad, Abraham, Noah, peace and blessings be upon them all. They are brothers, so there is no jealousy among them. My community will help Jesus. There is no, you know, like jealousy that we might feel in our circles. And the hadith continues, actually, the saying of the Prophet. The narrator says, the Prophet said, "They are like you or even better than you." Three times the Prophet repeated this. These helpers, they are like you or even better than you. And a community that I am the beginning and Jesus the end will not be disgraced, the Prophet says. That is the community of Islam. So it also has a good news for for the Islamic community. Jesus in the Sufi literature, I have a section in my book on this. So how about if I skip this part also, because we have many other things to say. So you read the book. I trust that you read the book. That's why I will skip this. Jesus is known as the prophet of love in Islamic teaching. Some Islamic scholars develop these aspects, especially this statement, to love, love, and hate, hate. This is emphasized, originally coined by a prominent Islamic scholar, Turkish Islamic scholar, Bediüzzaman Saitürk. And today is strongly emphasized by Mr. Fethullah Gülen, the concept of love. If you love love, love will increase. If you hate hatred, hatred will decrease. In fact, Mercy in one of the statements says, there is nothing deserves hatred more than hatred itself. So that way hatred will be elevated, if you hate hatred. So that is the point, actually. And that's why one of the aspects of Jesus is to be the prophet of love in this time. Now coming to the interpretive approach. Muhammad Abdu is a prominent Egyptian Muslim scholar. He's a modernist scholar, but unlike other modernists, he accepts the coming of Jesus, the descent of Jesus. Generally, Muslims use the term descent, coming from heaven to earth. And this is not related to the Christian concept of the descent of Jesus to hell, to rescue the people in hell. It's not related to that. It is a very specific case that Jesus comes at the end of time, descends from heaven. So Muhammad Abdu says, the meaning of the coming of Jesus is mercy, love, and peace. The dominance of his message. Mercy, love, and peace. So don't think of someone coming from sky, but think of these themes. That is the God. That's why the prophet emphasized the coming of Jesus. Emmanuel Muhammad Hamdiyaz is a Turkish commentator of the Quran. He also has a very interesting approach. But I have, in the book, I have an appendix. And this is the first time available in English. I translated from his book, his commentator of the Quran in Turkish. So I will refer to them as well. I'd like to elaborate on Nursi's interpretation. When he speaks of the coming of Jesus, he speaks of a dialogue between Muslims and Christians to bring justice and peace to our world. In 1911, he gave a sermon in Damascus. 1911. Which is considerably early. You know, at that time, the world was heading to the most catastrophic event in human history, the First World War. And this person was giving hope, talking about cooperation, dialogue, 100 years ago. He was so prominent a figure. Especially with regard to envisioning the future of humanity. So he elaborated on this dimension of Jesus. He speaks of the people of the book, Christians, Muslims, and Jews. And they're coming together, they are now. Now I made a rough calculation. If Christians, Muslims, and Jews come together, as Nursi suggests, and he understands the coming of Jesus in this dimension, in this respect, they constitute more than half of humanity. Christians, Muslims, and Jews, they make 58% of world population. and I think they can make change in the world. They can bring peace to the world. And this peace will not be helping only Christians, Muslims, and Jews. It will help Buddhists, Hindus, adherents of all other traditions, because this will be world peace. And they can do that. And I think I really like Moses' approach, because it seems to me that when the prophet spoke about the coming of Jesus, he was not speaking about a very simple event. He was speaking about a big issue. And if there is a peace through this, it's a big issue. That means really it will have a bright future. Humanity will have a bright future as a result of this. Now, this speaks of the renewal of Christianity and return to the original message of Jesus. That will be much more closer to Islam and to Judaism. The essence of the message of Jesus will be closer in this case. And therefore, they will be easier to come together in the future. It will be easier for these three religious traditions to come together. Common ground. Now, is this teaching that Moses suggests compatible with the overall teaching of Islam? My argument is that it is very much compatible. Because we see this in the Quran. Say this, Muhammad. Say this, declare this, announce this, the Quran says to the Prophet. O people of the book, come to a common word between us, that all of us worship none but God. Now this is an invitation, this is an invitation to Christians and Jews to come together. The Quran invites Christians and Jews. What is the largest umbrella that encompasses all of us? Believe in one God. The Quran invites to that umbrella. We all live in one God. Let's come together under that umbrella, the Quran says. And then work for the betterment of humanity. And then maybe we may have differences. We may talk about our differences. But the points that bring us together, there are many. And therefore, we can elaborate on the points that really unite us and come together and work for the future of humanity. So that's why I argue that in my book, I have a section on dialogue, and I argue that it is compatible with the essence of the Quran and the teaching of Islam. This is, again, a verse from the Quran. Diversity is a divine plan. If God will, he could have made you one community, the Quran says. But he didn't. Now, the verse, the Quranic verse, he has not made you one community. Therefore, vie with one another for good deeds. So what is the principle? Vie with one another for good deeds. So when I, mention this, I sometimes say there is no loser in this competition. Everybody is winning because you do good deeds, the other person does good deeds, and therefore you are helping each other. This is a competition. It's such significant competition that there is no loser. All are winning, and that is good deeds. Work and do good deeds. The Quran says. Dialogue in the Quran, we have some verses in dialogue. The Quran encourages Muslims to have good relations with Christians and Jews. The people of the book. This is the title that is given to Christians and Jews in the Quran. The people of the book. It's a tender title. In fact, it's many scholars, American scholars, Islamic scholars believe that this is a tender title because the Prophet used Ahl for his own family as well. Ahlul Bayt, the people of my family. Ahlul Kitab, the people of the book. The same term used for both. Now, this story of Muslim Christian cooperation in the beginning of Islam, there was persecution against Muslims in the Middle East. And Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, didn't have any chance except to migrate. So a group of his people, because they were marginalized, they didn't have any tribal affiliation, specifically were persecuted by Meccan pagans, Meccan idol worshippers. And the Prophet said, there is a Christian king in Abyssinia. Abyssinia is modern-day Ethiopia. If you go there, he will protect you. No one is wrong in his land. 50 male, 20 female Muslims together went all the way from Mecca to Ethiopia, to this land. And this king protected them. He is known as King Negus. The Prophet sent him messages. He sent messages to the Prophet. We have a remarkable early communication and interaction. This is showing that in the future, similar cooperation can happen. So Christians, Muslims, and Jews can come together and then have these similar cooperation. Today, I would say one of the pioneers of dialogue is Mr. Fethullah. He is. The thing that I like about Mr. Gulen the most, he doesn't speak a lot, he acts. In America, we have a kind of proverb, right? Action speaks louder. Action is more important. Mr. Gulen acts. He is active in dialogue. He is not only contributing verbally, but inspiring people to establish educational institutions. More than 1,500 schools around the world are actually inspiring people to be more peaceful, to be open to dialogue. And that is the future. That is the future of humanity. So he says, close the doors of greed, abhorrence, and hatred. So close the doors of hatred. They may be a small seed, but by opening the door, they could grow and become a huge tree of evil. So the best way is to close the door of hatred, so that there will be no way for it to become a tree. These are some pictures that show the dialogue. Mr. Fethullah Gulen meeting with Pope John Paul II. This was in 1998, before 9/11. He went to Vatican, he met with the Pope, and he discussed with him the way of dialogue, to promote dialogue between Catholics and Muslims. He met with Patriarch Bartolomeo, the head of Eastern Christian Church, Orthodox Church. He met with Israel Sephardic Chief Rabbi Rab Elia Bachshidor to develop Muslim-Jewish dialogue, which is very important, very significant. So he is very much active in this regard. And people are inspired by Mr. Gulen is establishing the institution around the world to work for this cooperation and dialogue. This Pope Francis, the reason I took this quote from him, he gave a talk at the joint session of Congress recently, last month, I think. And he emphasized the importance of dialogue. That gives me even greater hope. Because in my book, I argue that dialogue is the future. Now, having the help of the Catholic Church, which is over 1 billion people, same dialogue, I think it is important for the future of humanity. So it's very important dialogue. Now there are many other people who are working, other Muslims, Jews, Christians, who are working for dialogue. Dr. Sayyid is one of the important figures of Islamic Society of North America. He is the head of dialogue department of the organization. Now, I was part of this meeting. It was in Boston. And guess what? This was a dialogue between Muslims and Baptists. I mean, generally, you don't expect that. They were joking when they had the first meeting. They were saying, perhaps this would be the first and the last meeting between Muslims and Baptists. But actually, when I participated, it was the second annual meeting between Muslims and Baptists. And it was very successful. They asked me, I was one of the keynote speakers, and I said, I'm going to talk about how inner peace leads to outer peace. And they really liked it. They say, could you please put this in an article format? We'd like to publish it. So they published. My Baptist colleagues published in their journal called Baptist Quantum. It is there now. It's published, actually. So it is going on. Dialogue is going on. We have, this is in a larger dialogue group. Buddhists, Hindus are also included in this dialogue group. This is Pope Benedict XVI. As you know, he damaged Muslim Christian relations by one of his speeches in Germany. And he realized that how was destructive that speech. He went to Istanbul, he visited a mosque, he prayed with the Mufti of Istanbul in the mosque, so he repaired the damage that he actually caused. As a result of that. And then my final thoughts are I'd like finally to quote one of my, one paragraph from my book, and then I will be done. So this is the conclusion of my conclusion. The current trend of interfaith solidarity is a great step toward a peaceful future for humanity. It can be argued that when the prophet said that Jesus will come as a just ruler, he emphasized the importance of justice and peace on earth. If the trend toward dialogue and cooperation leads to justice and peace in our world, it will mean the fulfillment of the messages of both Muhammad and Jesus, peace and blessings be upon them. Thank you very much.
Now we're going to allow for a quick Q&A. So if we have any questions in the audience,
thank you, Professor, for your remarks, and I really loved the point about Muslim with a with a small M. And so thank you. Can you tell me about the demographics in Saudi Arabia at the time of the Prophet? I'm aware that there were Jewish tribes there, but I don't know where there are a comparable number of Christians. Hence the double references to Moses versus Jesus.
Yes.
So.
Well, I think, when we look at the Islamic history, we have more Jews than Christians. It seems like for example, in Medina, we have a good number of Jews. For Christians, we have a group of people known as the Christian of Najran, which is Southern Arabia. They were living in Southern Arabia. And we have some references that they came to the Prophet. They debated with the Prophet about the personality of Jesus. The Prophet says, you know, Jesus is not the Son of God, he is the Messenger of God. But it seems like they were, you know, saying that Jesus was the Son of God. And as you know, this is also an important difference between Christians and Muslims. Even there is a story that the Prophet said, you know, let's have mubahala. Mubahala is to ask God to curse the light. That was the tradition in Arabic. And the head of the Christian delegation said, I look at his face, the face of Muhammad. I said, this person is a true person. I am afraid that God will curse us if we accept mubahala. And he said, to the Prophet, we'll give you allegiance. Your faith is your faith, our faith is our faith. But we will give you allegiance. We will support you as parents. So, but that was in Mecca. Later they came to Medina and in Mecca, we don't have any reference that they were Christians or Jews actually. But in Medina, there were more Jews than Christians. In fact, we don't have reference that there were a good number of Christians in Medina. But there were at least three big tribes of Jews in Medina. And the Prophet, you know, we have like prominent companions of the Prophet who were Jewish by origin. One of them is one of the greatest companions of the Prophet, named Abdullah bin Salam. Abdullah, the son of Salam, Shalom. He's very prominent. He looked at the Prophet when the Prophet migrated to Medina. Look at his face. Abdullah bin Salam is very famous in the Islamic tradition. He looked at the face and says, this face cannot be alive. And he accepted the Prophet and his message. So we have many references that the Prophet had a strong relationship with Jews. In fact, Prophet's wife, Safiya, was a Jewish person, was a Jewish. So Muslims would say, our mother Safiya, she was a Jewish. In fact, I wrote in one of my articles, in one occasion, some people teased her of being Jewish. Perhaps it was teasing between tribes, Arab tribes and Jewish tribes at that time. And she complained to the Prophet and said, they are teasing me. And the Prophet said, tell them, your father is Moses, and your mother, your uncle is Aaron, and your husband is Muhammad. Who is happier than you? So tell them that the Prophet supported her to respond to those people who are teasing. So we have very interesting communication at this time.
I have two questions. First, there references to Christians in Islamic Arabic tradition as Nasranis, like, and you mentioned about helpers, like Hawali are helpers, and in this hadith, Muslims are helpers of Christians. So what's this notion of helping, and the name Nasrani to the Christians at the time? This is the first one. Second is your three approaches. You know, you said the literal approach, which is come directly from the sky, and the third one is, you know, the peace and, you know, the love comes to earth comes to me, I mean, peace comes to earth even more difficult than coming, Jesus coming from sky, right? So how do you describe this?
Yes. For the first question, I think Nasrani, the Arabic word Nasrani, Nasira is the village of Jesus. Nasra. You see, we have Nasra here also. It's the same. The same one. You know, Christians who migrated here gave that name of the place of Jesus. Jesus was born in Nasra. So in Arabic, it is not with Zayt, with Sa, which means Nasira. Nasir. So the Jesus of Nasira, the Jesus became the Jesus of Nasra. The same place. And therefore, they are Nasrani, that means they are belonging to that source. You know, like Jesus was from Nazareth. They belong to the Jesus of Nazareth.
What does it mean?
Doesn't mean help. It doesn't relate to help. But, Ansar means help. When Jesus asked, who will be men Ansari in Allah? The Quran verses. Jesus said, men Ansari in Allah. Who are my helpers? These are helpers. The concept of helper is used by the Prophet as well. When he migrated from Mecca to Medina, people in Medina were called Ansar. People in Mecca were called Muhajir. Ansar means helpers. And therefore, some people of Jesus said, we are your helpers in the way of God. So they became Ansar, means helpers. So this is the first one. The second question, yeah, it seems like peace is difficult, considering our world today. But I think it is not so difficult. Because human nature eventually will look for something good. Because human by nature is good. Because we are living in the era of mass communication, the remarkable era of mass communication, ideas change very frequently. And therefore, to work for peace, even small groups in the future may make a big contribution. Why? Because of the communication opportunities today. One important event, you know, like one tweet. Sometimes it is 1 billion times, you know, retweeted. So that means the future, the ideas can change very easily in the future. And I think that will serve peace in the world eventually. It is not easy, of course it is not so easy, but work for that and then ask God's help for that. And that's why I say Christians and Muslims and Jews, if they come together, they will make a big change. Through these venues of communication, they can make a big change. And I think they will come together. I'm very optimistic. I'm really optimistic about the future. Yes.
I have a question about the expectation of Messiah, and it's you're saying our current, some Muslims' current understanding, interpretation of the coming of Messiah is related to the idea that there will be a need, there needs to be a peace between members of different religious traditions.
Yeah.
And we know historically that in different periods, in at least in Islamic history, there were periods when people expected a Messiah, or there, when people said it's the apocalypse. Like especially the year 1000 for the Muslims, in the 16th century, it was an important period. There were so many messiahs around. My question is, was there any understanding previously in Islamic history, in Islamic intellectual history, that the end times is that related, or it brings about a peace, a harmony between, you know, different religious traditions?
Yes, that's a very good question. Maybe not per se, peace per se, But the idea of interpretive approach that I favor was actually mentioned by Saritoprak, which is considered a medieval Muslim theology. It also was mentioned by Al-Halimi in his Kitab al-Iman, the Book of Faith, which is even before Urdu. So they were talking about something, but very briefly, were suggesting that it shouldn't be understood literally. So there are some, but I would say the majority still thought that it will happen literally. I remember I was giving a talk and there was a Saudi person in the group. And he said, Dr. Saritoprak, I like literal one. And I said, why? He said, because it's easy. You just believe it and then leave it for God. God will take care of it. So yeah, I mean, people thought that way. But I would say there were scholars who were talking about allegorical meaning. And my argument here for this is that the Prophet used allegorical language, especially about future events. Intentionally, he used allegorical language. We have a saying of the Prophet in Al-Bukhari, the most reliable hadith source. Aisha, the wife of the Prophet, narrates this story. She says, we asked the Prophet, because his wives really loved him. Remarkable. So they said, which of us will join you first after your death? So which of us will die first after you die? And the Prophet said, the one whose hand is the longest. The one whose hand is the longest. And Aisha says, we started measuring our hands, whose hand was the longest. Then after the Prophet passed away, his wife Zainab passed away after the Prophet, about several months after his death. But Zainab was the smallest among us, her hand was the smallest. We understood that the Prophet meant the one who gives charity the most. Because in Arabic language, in the elements of Arabic language, when you say someone's hand long, means that person gives charity more. But if you understand as the length of hand, literally, you'll never understand the meaning of that saying of the Prophet. So the Prophet used allegorical language, and therefore it has to be understood in that proper language. Arabic language, and this is true for Hebrew, for Aramaic, this language, Semitic languages, are remarkably eloquent. You know, like in Arabic, for example, if you say there is a pile of trash in front of a person's house, what does that mean? It means the person is generous. Imagine, you know, if you go and look for a pile of trash, that would be wrong. Because that's not what's meant. What's the mentality there? This person has more guests. Because he has more guests, he cooks a lot. Because he cooks a lot, there will be a lot of trash. And because of that, there will be a pile of trash. But the result is that this person is generous. So this statement shouldn't be understood literal. It should be understood in allegorical way. The person is generous. You shouldn't look for a pile of trash. You should look for the generosity of the person. If the person is generous, that is true. The statement is true. I hope I answered your question.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Yes, please.
I always wondered about the demographics of Christians. And another question I wondered about was when he had the revelation of the Mount Hira, and his wife Khadija took him to her cousin, who apparently was a Christian. Is that true?
Yes.
So where as far as I remember, he number one, the question number one is, where was he? Was he in Mecca? And apparently he said that, I won't be living long enough to follow you. Well, he was living then, and Muhammad had got his revelation. So what was, why wasn't he just...
Yes, that's a very good question. That personality was Prophet Muhammad's wife's nephew, a close relative of Prophet Muhammad's wife. His name was Waraka bin Nawfal. Waraka was a convert to Christianity. He was a pagan originally. He converted to Christianity, but he was old. Maybe he was in his 90s when Prophet Muhammad narrated this story. As you mentioned, the Prophet had this experience of first revelation. Angel Gabriel appears to him while he was meditating in this cave of Hira, in the Mount of Hira. And Angel Gabriel appears to him and says, read. And the Prophet says, I am illiterate, I cannot read. And again, Angel Gabriel says, read. And then again, and then the Prophet says, he took me and squeezed me to my endurance and said, read in the name of thy Lord who has created human beings from a cloud of blood. Read, your Lord is the most generous who has taught human beings with pen what they knew not. It's unbelievable. In a society that there is no traditional pen, now is saying read and pen. It's believed that the population of Mecca at that time was about 5,000. Only 17 people were able to read and write. It was totally oral society. All cultures, all culture, all written literature was transmitted orally. And this verse comes and says, read. It's command, read. Well, then the Prophet comes back to his home and he tells the story to his wife. And he says, I'm afraid that I'm possessed. Something terrible happened. I don't know what happened. He was shaking. And his wife said, Muhammad, you are the most righteous person in our community. There couldn't be something wrong. There should be something true happens to you. And she says, well, Waraka, my nephew, has something about scriptures. He knows something about these experiences. Let's go and ask him. And then they go to him, and he listens to the Prophet's story. And he says, this is a good news for you. The person appeared to you was the same person that appeared to Moses, the same person that appeared to Jesus, to Mary, and that is Angel Gabriel. You will be the prophet of this community. I wish I survived so that I could support you. But it's believed that the prophet did not declare his message immediately. He waited for a second coming of Angel. Then a divine command comes to the Prophet through Angel Gabriel and says, now explain to people. And then the Prophet started to explain, because it says, first explain your community, your relatives, and then explain the people. But at that time, Waraka already passed away. And that's why in Islamic theology, there's a debate. Was Waraka really a Muslim? Because he didn't believe in the Prophet. Prophet passed away before he died. But then they say he was a Muslim because his heart accepted the message of the Prophet in the beginning, before he declared. So that's, yeah, it's a long story of Muslim.
I have another question, though. It's a bit complicated. He spoke, Jesus, I'm speaking of Jesus, he spoke Aramaic, right? And from what I'm getting with the gospel, when I read it, it's more like hadith to me. And when I look at the Quranic word Injil, that's evangel, that's not gospel. I don't know, but I'm getting the two things together. So, and if Jesus spoke in Aramaic, where is the original Injil or evangel? I can't believe gospel is evangel or Injil. I mean, I always have trouble with that.
Now, this is a question that my Christian colleagues have to respond to today, after Walter is here. But briefly, I can say something. What the Quran speaks of the gospel is exactly as a book like the Quran, like the Torah, like the Quran. God, as God revealed the Torah to Moses, revealed the gospel to Jesus, revealed the Quran to Prophet Muhammad. Was it recorded? Now, the Quran we have, you know, references that the Prophet he himself had some scribes, and they would write down immediately after the revelation. We don't have a reference that, you know, Jesus had scribes and they were able to write down for us. And he was declaring this message that we receive from God to help to his people. Some of them perhaps were written, some of them were not. So later the disciples wrote down what they remembered from Jesus. So Muslims would say that would be describing that message. Now modern scholarship speaks of Q gospel, which stands for Qur'an, and that means the source. It's believed that these synoptic gospels are referring to that gospel. That gospel would be more about what the Qur'an says. The Qur'an speaks of one gospel. It doesn't speak of four gospels, it speaks of one gospel. So, and the name of it, Injil, Injil actually is a Syriac word, and that means the good news. So the gospel also means good news. So it has connection.
Okay. If I may.
Yes.
One, you are correct that Jesus spoke Aramaic, but the Gospels are in Greek.
Right.
They have already been translated. Christians are not really bothered by the issue of translation or variant. Most Christians aren't bothered by that or variant readings, manuscript readings. First, as Zeki has said, in regard to the word Muslim, you have it with a small m and a capital M. A Christian would say that, let me try it with Islamically speaking from someone who is not a Muslim. The angel came from God to Angel Gabriel to Jesus. Okay? And that is the message of peace, love, compassion, and you can see that in the different sources. Christians would not put it that way. But the Gospels do not literally begin in a heavenly place, come down through an angel, and then to human beings. No. When we use the word, and I'll use big and little G, mm-hmm. or evangel, correct, it's the Greek word, that when you see it as a lowercase g, it is message. And it is the message of God's victory over evil, death, so on, through the crucifixion, resurrection and glorification of Jesus. It is message. There was a little g gospel before there was a big G document. When we look at the big G, but we, not everybody makes these distinctions, of course, but when we see gospel written with a big G, it is a document. The rabbi can tell you, similar with Torah. When Quran uses Torah, you've got a similar problem. Unless you're Orthodox. But the question is, in a sense, we Christians, Jews, Muslims, do not have an exact word of Jesus. What we have, the big J Gospels, are like hadith materials.
That's exactly what they said.
They're like hadith materials will tell you about Jesus that was the message of the Christian community that eventually was written in written form. I date them between 70 and 100. But you have earlier material. The question of the Q material is always a debatable one. But you can come back. I invite you to come back Tuesday night for our class. That's commercial.
I teach that too.
On Christianity and Islam in confrontation and dialogue. Or you can take a course in Moravian too.
Okay, I think there are no more questions. Well, thank you so much.
I want to thank Dr. Saritoprak for coming all this way to speak to our crowd today. Thank you very much for making the trip. It was very enlightening. And I also just want to thank staff and faculty that helped to organize and spread the word. I appreciate all of the help from those individuals, as well as all of you for coming out on your Sunday afternoon and participating in this event. As you know, we have another one coming up in March, March 20th, again, Sunday at 2 p.m. Dr. George Saliba from Columbia will be joining us. Anyone that's interested in purchasing a book, Islam's Jesus, written by Dr. Zeki Sanitoprak, we do have books in the back, and if he doesn't mind signing some of those books, we would appreciate that. And anyone who hasn't had a tour yet, I can show you around. We have a number of rooms that you may not have seen, so feel free to come up and I'll walk you around. Thank you again for coming out.